that certain someone you've been praying for. They'll be everything you dreamed of and a little more. In God's time. Oh, but no one knows, not you or me. It might be tomorrow or it might never be. Oh, but don't lose faith. Put it in His hands. Cause it might be that He might have a bigger plan than you had in mind. Miracles happen. God's time, in God's time, you'll finally get the chance to hold your baby girl, and all of a sudden everything will make sense in this crazy world, in God's time. Oh, but no one. God's time. You go to sleep and wake up with wings and learn to fly. And you finally meet your loved ones on the other side. In God's time.
I bet you could have used a minute, just a little time alone. But you let me be your little shadow, following wherever you would go. Then I got a little older, and you gave me space to grow. I don't ever seem to tell you enough, but I want you to know. When God made you my father, He knew who I'd need. When He picked you from the others, He could already see that you secrets, and you never ever judge. And when I'm falling in my weakness, you give me strength to stand back up. No amount of miles could separate us, no place where I don't feel your love. You say I'm the gift that heaven gave you. But Daddy, I'm the lucky one. Cause when God made you my father, He knew.
Well, good afternoon. On behalf of the family, we welcome you to the Celebration of Life service for our dear brother, Johnny. Your prayers and your thoughts are greatly appreciated, not only in this moment, but in the days, the months, and the year to follow. At this time, let us go to the Lord in prayer, and let us call upon the presence of the Sovereign Lord. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and at this moment, we call upon your name to fill this place with your peace, with your comfort. May this be a moment of refuge and solace. In a moment that is bittersweet, Holy Spirit, would you bring comfort upon the hearts of family and friends? Would you fill this place with joy as memories begin to flood our hearts for our dear beloved Johnny? Lord, we ask that you would guide us, that you direct us, not just here in this moment, but in the days, the weeks, the months, and the year to come. Would you surround the family with your comfort and peace? All this we ask in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. All God's people said, amen. At this time, we're going to have the granddaughter, Katie Sanders, come and read the obituary.
Johnny Filer, age 89, left this earth to join his heavenly father on May 21st, 2023, after a lengthy illness. He was born December 22nd, 1933, in Robstown, Texas, to Adolf and Isabella Filer. Johnny graduated from Banketti High School in 1951 and joined the United States Air Force from 1953 to 1957. On September 8th, 1958, he married the love of his life, Rose Hester, and they shared 64 and a half years of marriage together. After marrying Johnny worked in the oil field for a few years and then became a heavy equipment operator at Coke Refinery, where he retired after 35 years. Following retirement, he enjoyed country living, barbecuing for friends and family, and it was the best barbecue if you ever had it, you know. Playing dominoes, dancing, watching sports or sermons on TV, and hunting and fishing. Johnny was preceded in death by his parents, Adolf and Isabella Filer, and two brothers, Adolf Filer Jr. and Joe Allen Filer, and his son, Baby Filer. He is survived by his wife, Rose, three daughters, Brenda Kronovic, Terry Joy Jordan, and her husband, Lloyd, Audrey McElroy, and her husband, Alan, six grandchildren, Dustin Kronovic and wife, Christina, Brandy Anderson, and husband, Doug, Emmeline Jordan, Katie Jordan Sanders, and husband, Britton, Weston McElroy, and Misty McElroy. Four great-grandchildren, Ty Kronovic, Chisholm Kronovic, Mackenzie Anderson, and one on the way. And one brother, Leonard Filer, wife Bobby, and two sisters, Dorothy Schroeder and Olamay Beto. Numerous nieces and nephews, great nieces and nephews, and great great nieces and nephews. It's a big family. Johnny enjoyed volunteer work throughout his life as a Little League baseball coach and a 4-H leader in Nueces County. He enjoyed woodwork and crafting with his hands. There was nothing he couldn't put together, including the home he raised his family in. On Saturday mornings, he could be found in his cook shop listening to polka music and starting on whatever the evening meal would be, or checking on sausage that was hanging in the smokehouse. Johnny also took pride and pleasure in gardening both vegetables and flowers. Two of his proudest accomplishments in life were being awarded the MVP while playing baseball in the Air Force and being offered the position of private helicopter mechanic to President Eisenhower. Johnny will be remembered for being a godly man, his unfailing work ethic, mild-mannered ways of life, passion and love for family and friends, fantastic cooking, again, especially his barbecue, and fried fish and onion rings. His quirky sense of humor, telling entertaining stories, feeding the neighborhood birds, and sitting on his front patio eating bluebell ice cream with a fork right out of the carton.
What a beautiful testament to a life well lived. Amen. Well, at this time, we're going to enjoy two songs Johnny was very fond of. We'll enjoy one live, one recorded. So just sit back, just remember and allow the memories that you have just to flood your mind, just your soul, and your spirit.
Thank you.
cause trouble. Only you could know the pain. You weren't afraid to face the devil. You were no stranger to the rain. So go rest high. Gathered round your grave to grieve, wish I could see the angels' faces when they heard your sweet voice sing. Go rest high.
What an incredible message of hope in the lyrics of each of those songs. And my heart and my prayer this afternoon is that each of us would open up our hearts, both our hearts and our minds, to the truth and the hope that we have in the blessed assurance that is provided to all those who call upon the name of Jesus. When I think about the hope of heaven, I'm reminded of the words of the Apostle John, as he was given a revelation of what the kingdom, the eternal kingdom of God, looked like. And he records these words in the book of Revelation, in chapter 21, verses 1 through 4. And here's what the Apostle John writes. He says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God.'" And here's the hope. Here's the blessed assurance that we who have all placed our faith in Christ have. I think John captures this vision that he saw of the eternal kingdom of God, captures it well. He writes in verse 4, he, speaking of the one on the throne, speaking of the one who provides all grace and all mercy and all comforts, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. You see, what the Apostle John was capturing is truly something that in the depths of who we are, we long for. You know, in the Old Testament, there's a book that the great King Solomon wrote known as the Book of Ecclesiastes. And in that, he wrote these words that in the heart of humanity, God has placed eternity. In other words, in the depths of who we are, in the deepest desires of our hearts, of our soul, is something beyond this world, something greater, something more majestic than anything that we encounter in this earth could offer. And the beautiful thing is that we get a moment to taste and see what that is right here, right now, through faith in Jesus Christ. And it's bittersweet because moments such as this, you know, one of the interesting aspects about death is that it has a very peculiar way of reminding us about the importance of life, how fragile life is, how beautiful life can be, how precious life can be. And if there is anything that opens us up to this stark reality, it's when a loved one who is close to us passes. One whom we hold dear, one that we've experienced life with, passes. And when the passing of someone who is deeply loved occurs, that reality is amplified all the more. And so what I'd like to do, just very briefly this afternoon, is I'd like to draw our attention to the greatest comforts, the greatest hope, and the greatest assurance anyone on earth can ever have. This afternoon, my hope is that we will find comfort in a truth that offers solace, that offers peace, that offers comfort, that provides a place of refuge and certainty in a world that can oftentimes feel far from that. And much more, my hope is that by day's end, you will have embraced this hope and this truth and made it your own. You see, while we mourn and while we grieve over the passing of a loved one who will no longer be with us, the truth of the matter is, we can find comfort and we can find assurance in knowing that our dear beloved Johnny is resting in the arms of Jesus. That anyone who places their hope, faith, and trust in Christ as Lord will rest with him and in him for all eternity. You see, the ultimate healing, the ultimate joy, the ultimate peace, and the greatest comfort that we experience is not something that we can endure or even go through here on earth. But the greatest healing, the greatest comfort, the greatest peace is found in the eternal arms of our Savior Jesus Christ. And while we mourn a beloved husband, a beloved father, a grandfather, we can rest in that assurance that he is healed wholly and completely, 100%. And while healing does occur in the ministry of Jesus, while it does occur even now and again here on earth, the greatest healing is not that people can walk again, or that people can see again, or that people can hear again. Those miracles absolutely bear testament to the grace and the mercy of God. However, the greatest healing, and one that we should all long for, is an eternal healing. One that binds our life here on earth to the eternal life that we discover in God's kingdom. and I'm reminded of an incredible story in the life of Jesus. After he was baptized in the Jordan River by his cousin John, the scripture tells us that Jesus was filled with the Spirit, and he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. And if you remember this period in the life of Jesus, that occurred when he was tempted for 40 days. He fasted, and he was tempted. But I particularly love that story because of the phrase, led by the Spirit. You see, what the gospel author is capturing in that phrase is what is from the Greek word known as anago. And that Greek word, it paints this picture of a ship that is setting sail, that is breaking from harbor, that has a course that has been charted, has a journey that they are intended to go on so that they could reach a destination. And we know the ultimate destination, the ultimate goal in Jesus being led by the Spirit took him to Calvary, where he died for the sins of humanity. And in the greater context of our lives, and the life of our beloved Johnny, to be led by the Spirit, to be a child of God, is to be launched from harbor, to set sail on the ship of life, where a course has been charted by God himself for his people. And that ship is going and sailing towards its intended destination. Regardless of the storms, regardless of any pirates or marauders that ship might encounter, God has charted the course of his children. And our dear Johnny has reached his destination. His ship has sailed home. And for the Christian, this is what death is. It's a setting sail. It's a breaking camp. It's being freed from this life so that we can go home. The anchor is weighed, and we set sail for the golden shore of the blessed presence of God. And we are carried into God's eternal kingdom. You see, death for the believer is a going home. But it's even more wonderful than that because it's a home in which God is present. And so today, we are reminded of this blessed assurance. We are reminded of this promise and this hope that awaits all who call upon the name of Jesus. And though our hearts indeed are heavy with sorrow, and though we may experience a range of emotions, and that is absolutely okay to experience those range of emotions. Grief, loss, even moments of doubt, I remind us that we are not alone in our sorrow because God in his infinite wisdom, God in his unfailing love, he is here with us. And he is offering a comforting and sweet embrace for each and every one of us. You know, it's times like these when we think about that hope that we have in heaven. And I'm reminded of the words of the great apostle Paul. Here's what he wrote in 1 Corinthians 13:12. Paul said, "For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known." And so our beloved Johnny has entered into the glorious presence of God where he is now face to face and fully known, where he now sees clearly and absolutely, where he is experiencing the fulfillment of faith and the joy of eternal fellowship with our Heavenly Father. You know, I was told of a story where on Christmas, Johnny's shirt caught on fire. As he reached across the table, the candle took hold of his flannel shirt, and it just caught fire. And I began to think that Johnny now, he's sitting with Jesus at the table. And I imagine he's reaching across, maybe to grab some of that good barbecue, that brisket or fried fish. But his sleeve's not catching fire, because his soul has caught the fire of God's grace and God's love. And so the blessed assurance that we have in heaven rests on the foundation of God's promise in Jesus Christ and his compassion and his love that is reassured by his disciples when Jesus says these words in John 14. He says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." We heard earlier about Johnny enjoying the cook shop, listening to polka music. And the scripture says that the Lord has gone to prepare a place. Maybe he's prepared that cook shop up in heaven. And maybe he's listening to polka music right now. But these words of Christ, they provide us with an unwavering hope. A hope that transcends the boundaries of this earthly existence. And it's a hope that allows us to face the darkest of nights or the deepest of valleys with courage and with resolve, knowing that one day we will be united with the Son forever. And it's in this blessed assurance and hope that we find comfort, knowing that our dear brother has been welcomed into the arms of our Savior. He has been liberated from pain, from suffering, and from the burdens of this world. And it's a truth and a hope and an assurance that is available to any of us here this afternoon who would simply call upon the name of Jesus, who would turn to him in faith, would receive him as Lord and Savior. And so we remember that our time on earth is but a prelude to the eternity that awaits us. You know, Jesus said some more comforting words in John's Gospel, chapter 14, verse 27. He said, "My peace I leave with you. My peace I give you." And here's what's interesting about the peace that the Lord gives. Elsewhere in the New Testament, the Apostle Paul will write these words about this specific peace, that it's a peace that surpasses all understanding. In other words, many of us in this room can bear testament to this, that we can endure the darkest of valleys and we can endure the most difficult of circumstances. But even in all of that, what still reigns is peace in our hearts. Now, often that's beyond human understanding. That's beyond human comprehension. The human response is to get angry. The human response is to doubt. The human response is to ask questions. Why? And oftentimes, it's okay to go through those range of emotions. But we don't ever want to linger there. We want to be reminded of the greatest peace any of us can have. It's a peace that is provided through the blessed assurance that we have in Jesus Christ. So Jesus continues, "My peace I give you, not as the world gives, do I give you. Therefore, let not your hearts be troubled. Let them not be afraid." So friends, let's hold fast to this blessed assurance. Let's hold fast to this hope of heaven, knowing that one day we too, should we place our faith, hope, and trust in Jesus Christ, when we depart from this earth, we'll be joined with our Lord forever and ever. So may the peace of God, whose peace surpasses all understanding, guard the hearts and minds of those in Christ Jesus, and may this blessed assurance and this hope that we have in heaven sustain us through the days ahead until the day comes when we are in the everlasting embrace of our Lord, of our Father, and of our Savior. Amen. Would you pray with me? Our dear Heavenly Father, we come before you, and we thank you for the blessed assurance. We thank you that in you we can live life with hope and peace and comfort, And we thank you, Lord, that in the Son, Jesus Christ, all this can be experienced right here, right now. And so, Lord, at this moment, as we mourn, as we grieve, as we remember the life of our dear brother, I pray that if anyone who is present here does not know you as Lord, Holy Spirit, would you draw them to faith? Would you take them to a moment where they are sure that they are sure of the hope and peace that is found in you? May they repent of sin, and may they turn to Christ as Lord and Savior. All this we ask in Christ Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Well, at this moment, we want to provide an opportunity for you to share a word. Perhaps there's a memory, perhaps there is a humorous story, perhaps there's a loving moment that you've experienced with the family or with Brother Johnny. And so we want to open up the floor to anyone who would like to share a memory. I have found that that is how the legacy of our dear brother remains. And in the weeks, in the months, and in the year ahead, stories are going to enter into your mind. You're going to remember something. You're going to be sitting at the dinner table, and you're going to say, oh, do you remember this? Or do you remember when? And it's during those moments that you can find comfort and peace. And so if anyone would like to share a memory or to share a story, we're going to open up the floor at this moment. Would anyone else like to share? Well, I'm sure there are countless stories that many of you know. And I would encourage you, as you remember those stories, let the family know. Fill their hearts with the experiences that you have. And some stories over the course of the day and in the time ahead are going to cause tears to be shed and laughs to be shared. But it's through those moments that we're reminded of our dear brother Johnny and the peace and the comfort that he has now and for all eternity. And well, at this time, we're going to enjoy another song that Brother Johnny was fond of. So let's sit back and let's listen.
Oh, soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. Through death into life everlasting, he passed and we follow him there. Over us sin no more had dominion, for more than conquerors we are. And turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. His word shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is dying, his perfect salvation to tell. And turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
What a beautiful reminder. The things of this world will grow strangely dim in the light of God's glory and grace. Praise the Lord for God's glory and God's grace. Well, this time our service is drawing to a conclusion, but immediately following our time here, we will have a graveside ceremony over at the Sons of Hermon. Our funeral director will give us some guidance here in just a moment. At the conclusion of the graveside service, everyone is invited to join with the family for a meal over at the Lutheran Fellowship Hall, which is located two streets behind our building here. Again, on behalf of the family, we thank you for your presence here as you pay your respects. Your prayers and your thoughts are definitely welcomed and encouraged today and the days and the weeks ahead. We're going to have another song here in just a moment, as well as our funeral director gives us some guidance. But before we do that, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. We thank you for hope. We thank you for the assurance that is in you. May you continue to provide us with peace and guidance. Would you grant us direction, Lord, as we seek you? And I pray, Father, that you would fill this place, that you would fill the hearts and the minds of the family with your comfort. All this we ask in Christ Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.